Okay, the next item of business is a statement by Neil Gray on the Princess Alexandra I Pavilion. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I invite the Cabinet Secretary to address us for around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to provide an update to members on the Princess Alexandra I Pavilion in Edinburgh. Last week, NHS Lothian announced that from late October, the I Pavilion will be vacated for a period of around 6 months. This is to allow critical maintenance to be carried out and subsequent recommissioning of the site. It is clear that this will cause disruption to patients and to staff. I understand that both groups are concerned about the impact that this will have on arrangements for providing care and on waiting times. I am sorry for the worry that I know that this will cause for many. So let me start by being clear that my priority and that of NHS Lothian is ensuring safety and, to the fullest extent possible, minimising disruption. In my statement today, I'll provide further information on the critical maintenance that will be carried out at the I Pavilion and on the planning for those patients' appointments that need to be rearranged as a consequence. I hope that this will provide assurance to all concerned that this matter is being addressed with due care and speed. I will also speak to the future, the need for service and financial sustainability and for reform, and we know that change is needed and we must do things differently. First, let me briefly explain the issue that has led to the temporary closure of the I Pavilion. There are two copper waste pipe stacks that require to be replaced, and it is critical that this is done quickly to prevent damage that would require more significant remedial works and cause greater disruption. This is why vacating the hospital is being done at pace, with NHS Lothian planning to hand the building over to contractors on the 25th of October. With regards to the expected duration of the closure, the current estimate from NHS Lothian is 6 months. This is an estimate, and the timeframe and programme of works is being developed. It will be kept under review ahead of and during the works and recommissioning. In terms of what will happen during the period of closure and why this takes time, the site requires to be decanted before remedial works can be undertaken, and recommissioning is required before reopening. Decanting the site is a complex process and includes the moving of equipment as well as the relocation of clinics. Unfortunately, during surveys to assess the work required, it has been identified that one of the waste pipes is located within a cavity that contains asbestos. This adds to the complexity and the timeline of the remedial works. Safe removal of the asbestos material is essential ahead of the pipework replacement for the safety of those carrying out the work and for those who use the site. Once the remedial works are complete, the process of recommissioning is required to provide assurance that the site is fully operational and to ensure safety ahead of reopening. During the coming weeks and months, my officials and I will stay in close contact with NHS Lothian to seek the necessary assurances around progress. As I have said, patient safety is paramount, and following my visit to the I Pavilion this morning, along with Miles Briggs, Sarah Boyack and Daniel Johnson, I am assured that the Board are doing everything possible to minimise disruption and any potential harm to patients. NHS Lothian are looking at all possible options across their estate to maximise capacity for ophthalmology patients. After hearing directly from patients at a previous meeting on this issue, I have also sought assurance that there will be minimal travel for those patients with the most profound needs, a critical issue that patients have raised with me. The vast majority of patients scheduled before Friday, the 25th of October, will be unaffected, and the small number of patients that are affected will be contacted by NHS Lothian at least 2 weeks prior to their appointment. Patients who are booked for appointments from Monday, the 28th of October, will be contacted with changes to their appointments, and new patients will be given an alternative location in their booking letter. While NHS Lothian are still finalising all of the details of their plans, I have heard from them that the communication with patients, MSPs, local partners and government is and will be ongoing. And I know that they will have also they also have a planned meeting on the 4th of October with all Lothian MSPs, where they will share more detail following the conclusion of their final plan. The Board is also working closely with staff and unions for those staff that will be displaced to manage their concerns. Let me now turn to the future of eye care services. It is important to recognise that the replacement of the eye pavilion was included as part of the National Treatment Centre programme, intended to provide capacity for all of Scotland. As we look ahead, we must continue to plan on the basis of need and available resources across the whole of Scotland. The landscape has changed significantly since the National Treatment Centre programme started, not least as a result of COVID, Brexit and soaring construction costs. As we have made clear repeatedly, the financial climate is extremely challenging both across the revenue and capital budgets. We have also made clear that health service reform is essential for operational and financial sustainability. So our actions must enable NHS Scotland to maximise capacity, build greater resilience and deliver reductions in the number of patients who have waited too long for treatment. In this context, all spending, even that previously committed, must be carefully considered so that it is directed where it will have the greatest impact. We know that the NHS estate is ageing and that it is not affordable to replace everything as quickly as we might like, a position that is not unique to Scotland. We must make better use of our existing resources to support reform and improvement. And we must consider where strategic investment across our existing estate will provide better value than replacement. We must also consider how we can improve through service redesign to ensure that we have a resilient service for the future. So we are working with all health boards, including NHS Lothian, to develop a whole system infrastructure plan. This will consider health infrastructure needs for the whole of Scotland to support continued safe operation of existing facilities and inform longer-term investment priorities. As I have made clear, a key part of our consideration must be how how existing resources can be better utilised to provide the required capacity. We must also retain focus on preventing the need for hospital treatment in the first place. This means both investing in our existing estate and reducing pressure on that estate by delivering services in a different way. For eye care services, this includes consideration of how we better utilise capacity at existing treatment centres, and a key part of this is ensuring that more people are treated in a community setting where that is clinically appropriate. We know that treatment closer to home is of benefit to patients, with the potential to improve patient experience and overall health outcomes. And making better use of community services frees up acute capacity for more complex cases. The community optometry sector already provides a first port of call service to patients with eye problems, and this is enabled by Scotland being the only nation in the UK to provide free universal NHS eye examinations, a policy which this government is committed to maintaining. This has been really successful in supporting many patients to be managed within the community, closer to home, instead of needing to be referred to hospital or to be seen by a GP. However, the community optometry sector has the capacity and capability to do much more. An example of this is the new community glaucoma service, which moves lower-risk patients traditionally seen in a hospital setting to available capacity in the community optometry sector, freeing up hospital capacity for patients with the most sight-threatening conditions. This service has been rolled out nationally and will deliver the capacity and technology for an estimated 20,000 patients to receive their care closer to home. We're also investing in our future optometry workforce through Scotland's new UK-leading Master's Optometry undergraduate degree. This, amongst other things, will enable students to graduate as independent prescribing optometrists, and it will help build additional capacity to support more patients being managed in the community instead of being referred to hospital. The course has just launched at Glasgow Caledonian University, and the Public Health Minister and High Education Minister visited the university on Tuesday to meet the new students and teaching staff. The Government looks forward to the University of the Highlands and Islands launching a similar course next year. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I understand that members and their constituents are extremely concerned by the announcement that the Eye Pavilion will close for a period of time. I share that concern. So let me reaffirm that my priority, and along with that of NHS Lothian, is to limit disruption and avoid harm, and as well as ensuring that eye care appointments that would have taken place at the Eye Pavilion go ahead despite the temporary closure. I also know that many are concerned about the future of the Eye Pavilion and will be disappointed that I have not been able to confirm today its replacement in my statement. I give my commitment that we will continue to look ahead to how eye care services can be delivered most effectively, with a clear focus on improved services and reduced waiting times. We must be open to all possibilities on how this can be achieved, including how we make better use of existing services.
Thank you very much. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which we'll need to move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members wishing to ask a question who haven't already done so could press the request to speak buttons. And I call first Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you. Thank
Can I start by thanking the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement and also the time he gave to staff, patients and elected members on a visit to the Eye Pavilion this morning. As the Cabinet Secretary heard directly from clinicians this morning, the closure of the hospital and the significant disruption the service is now going to have has the potential to cause harm to patients here in Lothian. The fact that we are here is a failure to deliver a new eye hospital for Lothian over the last decade. There's been a failure of leadership by SNP ministers to plan and deliver for the growing health services we need here in Lothian. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that there is real concern amongst patients and staff that this might be just the start of a much longer period of closure of the hospital. We don't know until this work starts to be undertaken. It is now critical, therefore, that we see a commitment from SNP ministers to fast-track the funding and construction of a new replacement eye hospital. So can I ask two questions of the Cabinet Secretary? Firstly, if he will give a commitment that the Scottish Government will help fund the significant costs NHS Lothian will now face when we see the redistribution of these services across the NHS estate. And secondly, after today's visit, if he now fully accepts the case that we need to see a new eye hospital built here in Lothian.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Miles Briggs for his question and for his ongoing interest in this issue, the representation that he and others in this chamber are providing to their constituents, who I was able to hear directly from at a previous meeting here in the Parliament, as well as this morning. I think at the outset I must stress that everything that NHS Lothian is doing in providing the contingency arrangements during the temporary closure is about making sure that there is the least disruption possible to patients and reducing the risk of harm. And we heard that this morning. I recognise the increased financial pressure that this puts on NHS Lothian, so discussions to directly reference that question are ongoing as to how we can support that. And in terms of the new Eye Pavilion, he is well aware in terms of the capital programme pause that is underway in government and the fact that there is an infrastructure review ongoing and it will be determined based on both the outcome of the UK budget on at the end of October as well as the infrastructure review that is ongoing across government, and I can't give any greater commitment than that at this stage.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I also thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement and for the ability to meet with senior staff and colleagues and keep at the Eye Pavilion this morning. Let's be clear, though, that Eye Pavilion has been deemed not for fit for purpose for a decade, but this week's announcement will still have been a huge shock to patients and also deeply worrying to staff. So could the Cabinet Secretary give us a guarantee today that the Eye Pavilion will actually reopen in 6 months, that its closure will be an interim measure so that people don't have to worry about access to the vital services that will protect and save their sight when they need it? And will he also commit to updates in the coming months and in 6 months' time to Parliament so that we are kept informed and we can keep our constituents informed? And will he commit in principle to the importance of the need for the new Eye Pavilion, notwithstanding the challenges he has identified, the importance of the work of prevention, which I totally agree with, but patients and staff urgently need and deserve the new facility, which is safe, modern, meets everyone's needs, whether it's...
Cabinet Secretary.
OK. If you could answer...
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Sarah Boyack for that question and, again, for her interaction and her long-standing interest in this issue. In terms of her question around this being a temporary measure, it's absolutely NHS Lothian's intention to see the Eye Pavilion reopened and for it to be done so within the six-month timeframe. We heard this morning around some of the risks to that because of the uncertainty around some of the works. But I intend to keep a close eye on that, and that links into her second question, which is about keeping both MSPs and your constituents informed. There is a meeting of all Lothian MSPs with NHS Lothian on the 4th of October. It's my intention to keep close to this issue and to be able to provide updates from a government perspective as well. I will give a commitment that I will keep colleagues updated as soon as I hear anything further. In terms of the future for the Eye Pavilion, I've already set out to Miles Briggs as far as I can, but I accept and also agree with the point on the importance importance of prevention. That we can agree on. In terms of the future of the Eye Pavilion, that's going to be determined partly by the outcome of the UK budget, but also the infrastructure review that's going on across the Scottish Government.
Thank you. There is understandably considerable interest in asking questions. I intend to try and allow everybody who has requested a question the opportunity to pose that question, but I'll need some cooperation in terms of the brevity of those questions and indeed the responses. I call first Ben McPherson to be followed by Sandesh Gunlan.
The issue of having an eye hospital close to people, especially in emergencies, is of course a huge part of this, especially with significant growth in the Lothians. The Cabinet Secretary said that he has, and thankfully, sought assurance that there will be minimal travel for those patients who will be affected with the most needs. So therefore, can the Cabinet Secretary set out what support the Scottish Government will provide to patients in NHS Lothian who will have to travel further for medical appointments?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Ben McPherson again for his interest in the Secretary's questions, but his engagement with on a cross-party basis. As I've set out and as we heard this morning, it's NHS Lothian's intention, particularly those emergency patients that Ben McPherson raises, to be kept as close to existing services as possible. I think Ben McPherson and other colleagues in the Lothians will hear an update on that at the meeting with NHS Lothian on the 4th. It's their aim to see and treat as many patients as close to the city and the surrounding Lothian hospitals as possible. Should patients need to travel to a hospital outside NHS Lothian for treatment, patients are entitled to reimbursement of travel expenses or ambulance transport to help patients attend an appointment if the patient meets the assessment criteria. But having heard at the meeting that Mr McPherson was present at, the importance that is placed upon minimising travel for those with a significant eye condition, I've stressed to NHS Lothian the importance of keeping that as local as possible.
Sandesh Gulhani, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
A declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. This is a six-month minimum halt on activity at the Edinburgh Eye Pavilion. I fear the cost of remediation will spiral, and it is clear there is no plan as to where to undertake procedures requiring laminar flow. On average, over the last 5 years, 1,629 cataract procedures were carried out, 120 emergency eye procedures were carried out every 6 months. Where exactly will all these operations be carried out, and can the Cabinet Secretary guarantee to maintain the number of procedures during the closure and that patients' eye health will not be threatened?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, President Officer. Sandesh Gulhani is right to reference the risk that there is here to the capacity that has been provided by the Eye Pavilion, and I can't give a guarantee that that capacity won't be undermined because of the closure, the temporary closure of the Eye Pavilion. However, NHS Lothian is doing everything possible to maximise the capacity, not just here within the Lothians, but also further afield, to ensure that people are able to get access to the treatment that they need. Sandesh Gulhani references the high level of sanitation and the theatre level for some of the sanitation for some of the procedures that are required, as we heard this morning, and they're exploring all options to make sure that that is possible within the Lothians.
Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Asbestos is well recognised as one of the most dangerous substances still found in some buildings up and down the country, notably the Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that this closure is the best course of action to ensure patient safety while work is carried out to urgently remove the risk of asbestos in the hospital as a result of carrying out the plumbing system restorations?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I don't underestimate the anxiety that will be felt by Gordon MacDonald's constituents, nor those of other Lothian representatives across the chamber, which is why it's important for NHS Lothian to move quickly here and also to provide reassurances around maximising capacity in reference to Sandesh Gulhani's question. But I agree that this is the correct course of action and that I support NHS Lothian's plans to provide services elsewhere while rectification works are undertaken, exactly because of the points that Gordon MacDonald raises.
Daniel Johnson to be followed by Emma Harper.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary's acknowledgement of the points we heard this morning, that travel but also the loss of co-location of these acute treatments and emergency treatments would cause harm which would result in preventable loss of sight. So can I ask two questions? First, First of all, how will that be monitored and measured? But secondly, if there is a risk and an issue for the interim arrangements, surely that makes a point for the need for a replacement so that co-location of those facilities continues into the future.
Cabinet Secretary.
Neil Johnson makes a fair point, and one that underpins the decisions that have previously been taken around looking to see a replacement for the Eye Pavilion. I'm not questioning that. What I am saying in answer to this statement is the future infrastructure plans for across the health service are dependent upon the wider government infrastructure review and also the capital that comes available off the back of the UK budget, which Daniel Johnson will understand the implications of. In terms of the question on co-location and how that's going to be monitored, obviously clinicians have an important role to play there, as does NHS Lothian, and I expect to be kept updated on that.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Lorna Slater.
Given the increasing ageing population and expected need for more ophthalmic procedures to be carried out in the future, including at the Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion, can the Cabinet Secretary comment further on action taken to ensure the future resilience of specialist ophthalmic staff, including at the site, through recruitment of ophthalmology nurse specialists and consultants?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I thank Emma Harper for this question. I think ensuring that we are looking after the interests of staff and as well as patients within this process is critically important. It was part of the areas of discussion that we had this morning. A workforce review conducted by the National Eye Care Workstream identified that there are adequate ophthalmology consultants in post to support patient care in NHS Lothian, future-proofing the service by upskilling additional non-medical staff, and the use of ophthalmic imaging equipment will enable more patients to be reviewed in a sustainable manner. And there are a range of areas of intervention that I can write to Emma Harper with to give confirmation as to our support in this endeavour.
Lorna Slater, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for coming to the Chamber today to give us this update. It's clearly a frustrating situation for the board, for medics and for patients to be working in a building that's unfit for purpose for 10 years. Keeping this building going is going to get more costly and lead to more disruptions. The Cabinet Secretary hasn't set out a vision for the future of the Eye Pavilion. He has said that the Scottish Government will be reviewing this building as part of a whole infrastructure plan for the NHS. Can we find out when we will see that infrastructure plan, please, so that we can understand what the future of the eye services in Lothian are?
Cabinet Secretary.
The frustrations that Lorna Slater outlines, those felt by patients, by staff and by others, are shared by myself. And in terms of the outcome of the infrastructure review, that will be coming after the budget process.
Alex Cole-Hamilton, to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The closure of the Eye Pavilion will come as a bitter blow to campaigners, particularly Keep Edinburgh Eye Pavilion Campaign Group and Castorphin Sight Loss, who operate out of my constituency. But it is also a vindication of the fact this hospital has been not fit for purpose for some time. I am concerned by the discovery of asbestos. We know that where it's found in one place, it's usually in other places too. Does the Cabinet Secretary, is the Health Board aware of the full extent of the use of asbestos in this building? If not, are they looking to ascertain where else it is? And if they find more of it, will this lead to a longer closure?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Alec Cole-Hamilton for his question. Period of closure has some contingency built into it based on what might be found when works begin. But as I set out in my statement, there is going to have to be some flexibility. I hope that we are seeing the Eye Pavilion reopening before that six-month period elapses. But depending on what happens as the works get underway, there will need to be some flexibility as to the term of that closure. The identification of asbestos means that obviously that there are obvious safety parameters that need to be explored, and that has been built into the current trajectories in terms of the time that it will take.
Willie Coffey, to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you. I understand that to provide as much certainty as possible of the Scottish Government's investment plans, we are awaiting confirmation of capital allocations from the new Labour UK Government. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what conversations have been held with the UK Government to this end and what solutions have been offered?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Willie Coffey for his question. The First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government have met with the Chancellor of the Exchequer on a number of occasions and highlighted that the expected real terms cuts to our capital funding, worth about £1.3 billion, is significantly impacting our ability to fund vital infrastructure projects and deliver on our priorities and provide the certainty that Mr Coffey has outlined in his question, including investing in maintaining high-quality public services. So we are keen to work with the UK Government to ensure that the 30th of October October budget provides us with the capital budget we need to achieve net zero and maintain high-quality public infrastructure, as well as see economic benefit as a result.
Sue Webber to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Cabinet Secretary, earlier this week MSPs were told in a briefing that facilities across NHS Lothian will be used to accommodate Eye Pavilion services. The Eye Pavilion sees around 1,500 patients a week, with an average of 152 outpatient clinics a week using 40 consultation rooms every day. Patients and clinicians are going to be scattered across the city, and I can only imagine the chaos and confusion that this will cause. And that's before we take into account the devastating impact on clinical care. For months, I've been asking NHS Lothian what their backup plan is. Cabinet Secretary, will you finally give patients and staff the assurance that alternative, purposeful options outside existing NHS Lothian estate are being arranged, whether that be central office space, additional capacity in private opticians, hospitals and clinics?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Sue Webber for her question. The NHS Lothian are looking to make sure that the disruption and the co-location issues that have been identified across the chamber are minimised as far as possible, and will be setting out their finalised plans to Lothian's MSPs at a meeting on the 4th of October, where Sue Webber will be able to hear in more detail their plans to ensure that that takes place.
Colette Stevenson to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I recognise that the Scottish Government gave a real terms increase to our frontline boards, which has seen NHS Lothian's budget increase by £80.2 million this year. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise how he will look to protect and increase NHS funding where possible, despite a nearly 10% real terms cut in the Scottish Government's capital funding between now and 27-28 as a result of financial mismanagement in Westminster?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I thank Colette Stevenson for her question. As she sets out, a real terms uplift for the health portfolio was prioritised in the 2024-25 Scottish budget. I recognise, even with a real terms increase for health boards, including Lothian, that there are pressures maintained and that demand is driving those pressures. In contrast to our position, documents published as part of the UK Spring Budget set out a real terms 0.2% resource reduction for the Department of Health and Social Care, and the UK capital budget is expected to reduce in real terms over the medium term. So those spending decisions affect funding here in Scotland, as colleagues will be well aware, and ahead of the UK budget next month, I urge the UK Government to reflect on Lord Darzai's findings and to deliver on previous calls from this Government and organisations such as the IMF to prioritise investment in infrastructure and public services.
Martin Whitfield to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. A constituent who has an appointment in November told me that that appointment was cancelled in August with an explanation that there was a new booking system to be operated at the Eye Hospital. Is it just coincidence that this coincides with the closure?
Cabinet Secretary.
Without knowing the details of Martin Whitfield's case that he raises, I can say with some confidence that, yes, that is a coincidence, because this is something that's been found relatively recently. But if you'd like to write to me with the details, I'd be more than happy to follow that up with NHS Lothian.
Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you. Following up that previous question, can the Cabinet Secretary let us know when did NHS Lothian make this decision and when was he informed of the decision by NHS Lothian?
Cabinet Secretary.
I was informed around the same. I'll need to give Jeremy Balfour in writing the exact date and time of when I was informed, but it was around the same time as the public were informed. I think I was given an additional day's notice, but I'd be happy to provide that in writing to Jeremy Balfour.
And Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you. This news is deeply disappointing. We have known for years the Eye Pavilion was not fit for purpose, and now patients will face uncertain with rearranged appointments in unfamiliar places. The Eye Pavilion provides specialist care. If a patient experiences an emergency with their eye condition, A&E at the Royal Infirmary may not be able to meet their needs. Can the Cabinet Secretary say where patients will be sent for urgent care now?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Faisal Chowdhury for his question. I recognise what he is highlighting as a concern, as it was discussed this morning at the meeting at the Eye Pavilion that were attended by his colleagues. And it is an area that NHS Lothian are also acutely concerned about, ensuring that there is a minimisation in travel and disruption for patients who are in need, in particular of urgent care, as Faisal Chowdhury sets out, and the final details of where people will be receiving those services will be set out, I believe, at the meeting on the 4th of October with NHS Lothian and Lothian MSPs.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes this item of business. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.